incredible capabilities to process the information and to solve the problem than the traditional approach that we used to have. And the approach which quantum computing takes, which is far more different than the traditional computing. So approach which quantum computing delivers, which is very fast in a speed and more capable to solve the difficult problems, which is purely based on the quantum mechanics. And here we are to talk about how this quantum computing will disrupt the security, or how it will have impact on cyber security. We know that traditional cryptography algorithms like RSA and AES, encryption standard, they built on a traditional cryptography standard, which is random key generation. But in the emerging of quantum computing, will that disrupt the cryptography, or it will disrupt the foundation of traditional cryptography? We don't know. So in order to talk on that, we have an industry expert from the QNO lab who is going to take on this quantum computing, or the what will be the nuances associated with it, and what will be the effect of quantum computing on the cryptography or a cyber security per se. And he also going to talk about post quantum cryptography and the QKD mechanism, and we'll also talk on the what are the impact that will have on the security. Will that quantum computing will break the encryption standard which we have right now, or it will not? So I'll hand over to Mr. Ravi to deliberate his thoughts on the same. Yeah, over to you, sir.
Thank you, Vivek. Am I audible? Right. So this was a saying by Edgar Allan Poe way back in 1841, basically that human ingenuity cannot concoct something which human ingenuity cannot crack. With that introduction, I'll take you to the topic, which is quantum cryptography, an emerging imperative for cybersecurity. Now, cryptography, as you know, started way back in several hundred years BC, right from the time of ancient Egyptians, Sumerians, Greeks. They all had simple substitution ciphers, or a matrix-based system where you substitute certain letters with some other and make it unreadable. Basically, cryptography is the science of making data unreadable or encrypting certain text. This really became prominent in the World War. Towards the end of World War I, the Germans came up with the Enigma. You must have heard of it. And till mid of World War II, the Allies could not crack the Enigma code. And once they did, and they did develop the machine to counter that, it became easier for them to counter the German moves. And after automation came in, that is when the modern cryptography has evolved, which is much more complex, and as of today, very, very robust. But not for long. I'll tell you why. So I'm going to cover my lecture like this. Basically, to take you into the topic, a brief review of cryptography, where it has reached today. What are the problem areas that we face? The emerging threat due to the advent of quantum computers. We'll talk about the status of quantum computing, preview where it is exactly now. And then we shall talk about the quantum answer to the quantum threat, the quantum cryptography. And more in detail of quantum key distribution, which is what we deal with in QNO Labs. A brief introduction to QNO Labs, and we shall have a Q&A session after that. So to just acquaint you with the standard norms in cryptography, conventions, you have Alice talking to Bob, and they use some kind of system to encrypt the text. Eve is the eavesdropper in between. There's also another kind of eavesdropper called malicious eavesdropper called Mallory. Now, the simple thing is you have some kind of a mechanism, algorithm, which mixes plain text with the encryption key. And both sides have the same algorithm and the same key, at the other side you are able to decrypt it. This is the basic principle. And cryptographically secure implies confidentiality, integrity, and authentication. So there are two types, basic types of cryptography. One is symmetric, the other is asymmetric or public key cryptography. Now, when you know the other party with whom you are going to communicate, you can able to decide what key you want to use. And that is where you use the same key, and same key means symmetric, which is the symmetric key cryptography. Both have the same secret key at both ends, is used to encrypt and decrypt at both ends. But what do? When you typically transact over the net or you want to transact with an unknown party, you are not able to share the key. That is where public key cryptography comes in. Now here you have two parts of the key. One is your public key and the other is the private key. You encrypt with the public key and you decrypt with the private key. Now public key can be made known through classical channels in public domain. It is like sending a box with a lock to Alice. Alice is required to transmit something to Bob. Bob sends a box with a lock. She puts it, locks it, sends it to Bob, and only Bob has got the key to unlock the box. That is the principle. There are various modes of encryption. It's not relevant for the talk today, but just to mention. But for unconditional security, whatever key you use must be truly random. It cannot be intuitively discerned, and it should not be repeated. It should never be reused. There are various instances in history where critical information was lost or codes broken because of keys being repeated. Let's have a look at what is the kind of effort required to crack and how these algorithms are good as of today. If you see the key size, and typically we use a 128-bit AES standard today, the number of combinations that are possible is 3.4 into 10 power 38. That is, I don't even know how many quadrillion after quadrillion what comes, but it's more than the age of the universe. That many number of combinations. And if you were to crack it, if you were to go by a statistical method, systematically taking one key at a time and trying it, number of iterations. If you have a supercomputer to do it, if you do one iteration in 1 microsecond, it will take you about this much time. Is it readable? And if you have a very large computer which does 1 million bits iterations in 1 microsecond, even then it will take you of the order of 10 power 19 years. So this is not impossible to crack, but it is called intractable. We can't spend that much time. Now these estimates are purely statistical. They discount the advancements in mathematics, they discount the advancements in computing power, and they discount human ingenuity. And you could also have this luck factor that you may probabilistically turn lucky. So if they are so good, what is the problem? The problem is twofold. For this, one is that you need to protect data both during storage and transit, and that is to be protected for a long time, and therefore your key management becomes difficult. And then how do you distribute the key? So in symmetric key, since you know the other person, you can have various methods. You can have the one-time pad, which is literally a pad which has got the printed keys. You share the pad every day, you tear one page off, load those keys in the system, you are safe. And then you could send the keys on a physical medium, CD, pen drive, etc., or use some kind of secret methodology to drive the key. Now, in the armed forces and intelligence agencies, we have very, very elaborate systems. I'm an ex-army officer, by the way. So we have very elaborate systems there, and the keys are so secure that nobody can get hold of it, and even if you get hold of it, there are fail-safe mechanisms to overcome it. But whereas now in the corporate sector, there is no concept of key management, and this is a big loophole that exists. In public key cryptography, the system itself arranges for the exchange of key. Like I told you, you're sending the lock and keeping the key with you. Now one use of this is, you can use this public key cryptography. The example of this is RSA, that typically is called the Diffie-Hellman protocol, and RSA is the most widely used system. You can use this to transmit the keys between two symmetric entities. So I talked about the advancements in mathematics. Now all those statistical estimates are discounting these, that it is theoretically possible to crack this. And in the new algorithms which have come about, the two important algorithms which affect cryptography directly is Shor's algorithm and Grover's algorithm. Now, Shor's algorithm, just to mention that RSA, the Diffie-Hellman protocol, would take about a few quadrillion years to crack in a normal computer. But if you have the Shor's algorithm running on a quantum computer, the same thing can be done in a matter of seconds. So you can imagine what this is going to happen. The day the quantum computers are going to come to a certain level where you can crack, this has been theoretically proved, experimentally proved. Only thing, the quantum hardware has not come up to that level. The algorithm is proven. The day hardware comes up to that level, overnight our entire backbone of our digital economy will be lost. It will become obsolete. The entire transactions, your SSH, your digital signatures, your banking transactions, everything, everything has to be changed. So the preparation has to start now for that. Second is the Grover's algorithm, which is for the symmetric keys. Now, statistically, if there are n combinations of the key, you would take n by 2 iterations to crack it, if you go systematically. Using Grover's algorithm running on a quantum computer, you can do the same thing in root 10 iterations. So there's a quadratic speed up. And if you use a number of quantum computers, you can probably crack the symmetric key also. So both the systems of encryption that are in use today are under threat with the advent of quantum computers. There's another aspect that, you know, people are complacent. They say, okay, that's, we'll cross that bridge when it comes. We don't know when quantum computers are going to come. So let's look at it that way. That's not true, because you have to see for how long your data has to be kept confidential. If your data needs to be kept confidential for 10 years, like financial information, and your quantum computers are going to come in a big way in 5 years, then you're already insecure. You've got to take steps to correct this thing. So these are the vulnerability levels. Before that, you must have heard of the RSA example in 1977 with a lot of fanfare. They announced a challenge of a 428-bit key. They said that it will take 40 quadrillion years to crack it, and they offered a $100 prize to anybody who can do it. Within 20 years, with just 6 months of effort using parallel computing over the NIT, somebody cracked this and claimed the $100 prize. Now, if you see the various systems that are in vogue today, DES is definitely insecure. It has already been cracked, proven to be cracked. This is the standard environment now, given the state of the art of mathematics, computing power, and quantum computers. AES with a 256-bit key, mind you, we are using 128 now. Even with a 256-bit key, it is quite likely insecure. Your RSA is likely insecure. Now, incidentally, RSA is de facto dead. There are it is known to have trapdoors built into it, which the US has been exploiting to snoop on various communications. We know that, but we have no alternative. We continue to use RSA for everything. And the only theoretically secure system that you can say 100% secure is the one-time pad. In one-time pad, what happens is you take a bit key of the length equal to the message and XOR it with that. Once you do that, there is no system that can crack it, either human or machine. So that has got relevance in quantum key distribution. I'll come to that later. This is the acknowledgement of the threat from quantum computers. It's not a bogeyman which people like us in the industry are trying to create. ETSI has stated that without quantum encryption, everything that has been transmitted or will ever be transmitted over a network is vulnerable to eavesdropping and public disclosure. Quantum Safe Security Working Group has recommended QKD for future-proof security. And US National Security Agency is taking this seriously and has already announced transition plans for various algorithms. Now, leaving quantum threat apart, people say, like I said, that's a bridge we can cross later. But even before that, today the environment has changed in that every organization has moved its operations to the cloud. Now you are linked to the data center or to the cloud. That becomes vital. And if you see all cybersecurity, even this conference, every conference that you attend, you find all the steps are directed at the higher levels of the OSI model. If you take the OSI model, it's at the higher levels. You have got intrusion prevention, you got anti-ransomware, anti-malware, antivirus, all those kinds of things which are within your network. But what about outside your network? We were complacent because the encryption was there. but no longer. Today the state of affairs is that if I ask you in this room, do you know how the routing of your line is to your data center? Many of you will not know. And if you do you know whether that is being secured? You'll say, yes, we released a secure line from so-and-so as a service provider. But who's managing the keys? How frequently is it being changed? Is the key truly random? Who has access to the key? Can he be bribed? Now, it's such a simple matter to bribe someone and take that key, and your entire data is at risk. You imagine the link leading from a bank to the data center. If that can be tapped, you can store the data. Even if you can get hold of the key, I'm sure in India you can get hold of the key. If you can't get hold of the key, store the data and keep it. In another few years, you'll be able to crack it with quantum computers. And that is enough to hold the bank to ransom. So this is a real and very effective or a disaster just waiting to happen. I've been talking to bankers, I've been talking to the IDBRT and all that, and they are blissfully unaware of this threat. So just to reiterate, OFC is very easy to tap. One can store that data now to be cracked later. Most links are not even encrypted, or people are unaware of the status. Key management is not understood. Key changes are not frequent. Key management is entrusted to service providers, which is like, you know, giving the keys to your safe to somebody else, to a third party to handle. And the keys are not robust enough. So all that is required is get the key, store bulk data, extract transactional information that depacketizes software is there, and crack the RSA encryption. That's all. So compromise of keys cannot be, by treason, cannot be ruled out. I also give an example from history. We have these magnificent forts all over the country. Invariably, those have not been destroyed by military action. Siege has happened for months together and people have held out, and ultimately somebody has been bought out who opened a trap door or a back door and the enemy gets in. Same thing is going to happen to your data. Now, when I was pitching once in one of the competitions that has held here, one of the panelists, I said, we can tap the OFC. He says, no, I spent a lifetime laying OFCs. OFC cannot be tapped. So after that, every presentation I show this short video clip to see how an OFC can be tapped.
Cable. I have a model of a typical system here, a client PC with a cam running, taking pictures of me, streaming pictures and video to this fiber optic cable over to this PC where I see the same. You can see there is connection through here. And in order to steal data from this fiber optic cable, you need a device like this, a clamp-on device which I purchased on eBay for $500. And that just needs to connect to the fiber optic cable like this. And then you will have all data from this fiber optic cable through this cable onto this sniffing PC, where I can have all copy of whatever data is running on this, this fiber optic cable.
So you see that he's very easily tapped it. This device, we also have this device. It costs around $500. Anybody can buy it on eBay. And there are n number of videos on YouTube. You can see how you can tap email, all your data. Everything that is going on your line is insecure today. And you can go and pull out an OFC from anywhere. It is so simple as that. So, with that, let us come to quantum computing. And we were talking about the threat of quantum computers. So basically, the concepts based on which quantum computing is built are two things. Now, in the quantum world, it's entirely different from the classical world. It's counterintuitive. Everything, all the rules or laws of physics break down in the quantum level. And you have strange occurrences. The two principles which affect us or based on which quantum computers are built are superposition and entanglement. Superposition means that unlike a normal bit which can exist in a state of 1 and 0, in the a quantum bit or a qubit can exist in three states, 0, 1, and then 1 and 0. 1 and 0 or 1 or 0, or you can say that's called the superposition state. So you have three states depicted by one bit. So if you have two bits, you can have 8 states instead of 4 as by standard thing. So with this principle, If you build your quantum computer based on superposition states, you can simulate a large number of data sets. Now, second thing that is there is entanglement, which is that you are able to, you can link two quantum objects or quantum bits together by some means. If actually you create two photons, there's a principle called parametric down conversion. You create photons at the same time, they share properties. And then if you separate those photons, no matter how far they go apart, their properties remain linked. Now this was famously objected to by Einstein, who didn't accept this. He said that if I can do something here and at that distance something is happening, that means I'm breaking a fundamental law of physics that you are able to send some information faster than the speed of light, because light does not reach there, the instant in there. But there was an error in that understanding, because it's not actually action that is happening. He called it spooky action taking place at a distance. Now, it's not action that is happening, it's a kind of correlation. You can say that if one particle is having a spin up spin, the other one is having down spin. So if they are separated and at one place I measure that this has got a down spin, I know what is the spin of the other particle. So now qubits in superposition states can be entangled with other qubits. So you have this the simulated conditions grows bigger, and those in turn can be entangled with different pairs. And like this, you keep on entangling it or mixing it together, you reach a large state of super entanglement. And with just a few qubits, you can simulate very large information. They say that the entire universe can be simulated. And the corollary of that is that probably the universe is a quantum simulation, which matches with some of our ancient theories, that is, what is real is not real, or is just an illusion. Maybe. But that is where the bridge is going to come between science and spirituality. So based on this, how they are actually doing it is, you have ions or photons or single atoms which are kept held in some condition where you can manipulate the properties of that. And then you simulate entanglement or interact with them through microwaves. And this is the principle that they are doing, and different companies are doing different things. And there are a large number of projections that are taking place. This is the Gartner report on how quantum computing is going to affect various fields today. But you also know that historically, no technology prediction has ever come true, right? 25 years back, I was attending seminars like this on the advent of information superhighway into India and what we can do with it. And none of those reports, none of those studies could even come close to how internet has affected our lives today. I mean, we just couldn't imagine this. Where we have reached here. So how can you imagine how quantum computing is going to take us? It's unimaginable. There's another school of thought which says that this present approach of quantum computing is not the right way to do it. Now, let me just draw a difference between classical and quantum computing. If I usually give this example, if I lay out certain objects on a table and I ask you to pick which is the biggest object, you will instantly do it. Next question I ask you is, how do you know it's the biggest? You don't know. You just know that it's the biggest. That's because your brain is not operating like a classical computer. It's a quantum computer, and you have developed certain algorithms in your brain to instantly visually appreciate that and recognize which is the largest object. This started when you were a baby, when your mother taught you this is biggest. And then over the years, lifetime, you have developed algorithms for everything, to put a basketball into the net or to do anything, to drive. Various algorithms you have created to use your quantum computer to do things. And that is how a quantum computer works. Classical computer, on the other hand, if I ask it to find out which is the largest object of 10 objects, it will take the first two, compare, reject one, take the next one, compare, reject one. It will do the complete iteration. It's a really silly way of doing it, but that's how it does it. Only thing, it does it very fast. So we think it's smart, but it's not smart. So a quantum computer is supposed to be smart. Now, I told you that we don't know how this is going to affect our lives. But almost like an exception, this small field that you see here, encryption, we know exactly how it is going to affect. Because, like I said, a quantum computer requires an algorithm. So to do all these things, you need to create algorithms first, how you're going to use it. And those are not being created. But in the case of cryptography, we already have the algorithms, namely Shor's algorithm and Rover's algorithm. this is the status of, so it's a writing on the wall is very clear. As far as cryptography is concerned, quantum computers are going to completely make it obsolete and we need to have new methods. So this is the status of quantum computers. We had most famously IBM in December last year, they reached the quantum supremacy threshold. Now quantum supremacy was for a long time regarded as 50 qubits size. So there was a race between Google and IBM to reach this. And IBM announced that, so now Google has said that this year they'll come up with a 72 qubit computer. Though they have done that, they do not have an algorithm to prove that it is quantum supremacy. They're not able to show an experiment where the largest supercomputer cannot do something which the quantum computer can. So that is why it has not been demonstrated, but they are waiting for that. So Google, Intel, even startups like Rigetti, and this is the D-Wave 2000 computer, which was sold to last year to at $15 million to Temporal Defense System for cracking cryptography. Now D-Wave is the only company which has built and sold quantum computers, but their technique that they use, something called annealment, is not agreed to by most of the other players. So it's a different technique. So if you see the exponential rise in the qubit number from where, from 2000 till 2018, we have reached 72. You can see where the graph is going to lead. And to all questions the people ask, will these quantum computers ever come? I mean, it said there are two schools of thought. But I want to ask you, this, for the first time in history, you have something which a lot of governments, all the big countries, all the big companies are pouring in billions of dollars. It's almost as if the entire humanity is coming together to address one area. Can we fail? I don't think so. So this is just about to happen. We only have to see what shape it takes. And I would say with 72 qubits that the quantum era is already here. Other thing difference is, unlike supercomputers, which like somebody brought out today morning, that Anurag, it occupies 3-4 rooms. That's only accessible to governments and intelligence agencies, etc. Unlike that, quantum computers are going to be available to all of us online. This is the IBM, access to the IBM computer online. You have tutorials, you have examples, solved examples, you have communities to help you how to do it. You also have a proven or implementation of the Grover's algorithm there in the IBM computer. So I've shown you how to tap the cable. I've shown you that access to the quantum computer. I said that also you have the algorithm. Everything is in place for a disaster. So what is the solution to this? The solution is again a quantum solution. And you can call it quantum cryptography. It's got two basic divisions. One is the post-quantum cryptography and quantum key distribution. Like I mentioned earlier, that no matter how good your algorithm, if your key is stolen, your system can be cracked. So it is not enough to build good systems. You also have to ensure the safety of the key. And today, there's only one technological answer to ensuring safety of the key, which is QKD or quantum key distribution. Now PQC or post-quantum cryptography is a whole lot of new technologies, new algorithms like lattice and hash-based cryptographic primitives which people are working on, which so far is proven safe until proven otherwise. Now it's not difficult to create an algorithm, but if the whole world has to operate on certain standardized system, that is where you need to have an agreement. And only last year, NIST has called for papers on this. They are evaluating those. And by the end of this year, probably, they will specify the new cryptographic primitives which are going to come in. Then, over a period of time, we will all have to change over our existing systems to the new algorithms. Quantum key distribution. In 1949, Shannon presented information theory in which he proved that, I mentioned about OTP, that when you XOR an equivalent length key with the data, that is 100% secure, it cannot be cracked. Now, QKD principle is this, you transmit the key in a secure way and you use that to OTP with the data. That is information theoretically proven secure. There is no other system safer than that. However, to do that, you need to generate the keys very fast. So we don't do that. We follow a hybrid system where we generate the key and use that in AES to encrypt it. Only thing, you can change the key very fast. So you can change the key as quickly as 1 per minute. So the AES is also secure. QKD is provably proven secure. It is guaranteed by the laws of quantum mechanics. This was started in 1984 by Bennett and Broussard, and that's why their first protocol was called BB84, based on polarization. And that was just in a 1 foot or 30 centimeter distance that they built it. But the basic principle has remained the same after that. This is based on the principles of quantum physics, that observation causes perturbation. It is independent of the mathematical power of the adversary to tap or crack it. Information is encoded in the properties of light. I shall explain this in greater detail as we go ahead, as quantum bits or qubits. And it is able to provide the highest security levels which can withstand current and future threats. It is theoretically proven to be unconditionally secure. So the basic principle is, in classical physics, observation does not cause perturbation. In the quantum world, if you measure something or try to read it, read this parameter, you end up changing it. So that is called subjective reality. And that is the principle on which it is based. I shall explain this principle with the BB84 protocol. So QKD is used for secure key exchange. And in this, in BB84, we are using the polarization of photons as the property used to encode 1 or 0. You can have sets of polarization, vertical, horizontal combined, or diagonal combined. And if I say that 0 is depicted by horizontal or a right tilt, and 1 is depicted by vertical or a left tilt, when Alice sends the key to Bob, she encodes it randomly with this protocol. And so you see these bits going across. Bob doesn't know what she has sent. Bob is going to measure those randomly. He selects the basis, whatever. Now the property of, I told you about the quantum level, this is the diagonally polarized bit which is coming. Bob uses a horizontal vertical combine. What happens is the bit comes out horizontally polarized. So he has ended up changing the system. So that is wrong. So some are correct, he'll get 50% of them right, 50% wrong. All he does is records the basis, records the results, and then sends this basis that he has used with the timestamps to Alice. Alice, since she knows what bits she has sent, she'll be able to tell Bob, look, this is wrong, drop these bits. This process is called sifting, and with that sifting, like this is the wrong keys, Alice tells to drop it, and they arrive at a smaller key, which is called the sifted key. So this is the principle of key derivation in QKD. How is it actually done? You have your standard communication channel. Basically, you have encryptors at both ends. And we add one more layer to that, where we need one more fiber called the dark fiber or the quantum channel, which is used to transmit the key. And this is the QKD system. And the interactions that I mentioned happen on the classical channel. So we'll run you through the steps. First step is authentication, where Alice and Bob authenticate themselves, because one of the ways of attack is man in the middle, where Eve comes and tries to impersonate Bob. So you have to first authenticate that the other side is genuine. And then next, Alice sends a stream of raw bits encoded in this polarization. Thereafter, this key sifting process, which I explained, how Bob sends the basis and Alice decides which of them are to be dropped. And they arrive at a mutually agreed key. After that, Bob also sends a part of the key back to Alice to check how much errors are there. Now what happens is, if eavesdropping takes place, like I said, when you try to measure something, Eve tries to measure the polarization, she ends up changing the system. So every measurement causes the perturbation, and this will all add up as errors. So in QKD, whenever the error goes beyond a certain percentage, we assume that somebody has tried to tap the key, and we discard it and start the process again. So therefore, if you are able to sift the key properly, you know that the key is unconditionally secure. So next, we do one more stage of operation to make it, that's called privacy amplification, to make it 100% secure. And then these are transmitted to the encryptor, which will have a buffer of these keys and use it. And you can set the policy to change it as frequently as you need. This is the effect on key size. If the stream of bits that Alice sends is so long, after sifting you have a reduced key set, then after error correction it further reduces. Privacy amplification does nothing. Each step adds another layer of security, and you end up with a small refined key which is 100% unconditionally secure. This is another way of implementing. There are various protocols on how to implement it. Our product is following this, so I thought I'll show it. It's called the differential phase shift. Those of you who are in the communication field will know the differential phase shift keying. So you encode ones and zeros by combination of the phases of two consequent adjacent photons. And at the other end, through an interferometer, we are able to discern this. And if this detector clicks, it is 0. If this detector clicks, it is 1. Okay, ways to implement QKD. Typically, this is meant for the optical fiber-based communications, but you can also have free space and satellite-based communication for larger distances. Here we use visible light. This is more in the infrared region, the second window of the optical OFC communication. So this technology, like I said, started in 1984, but over a long period, there was a lull. There were experimental evaluations that many countries took up, Europe, Japan, in the US. There were a combination of different companies, different governments. They did experiments, and it's only Switzerland which has implemented in its banking system for its electoral results, and even for the FIFA World Cup. I don't know why they had to secure that, but they did that. It's only recently that, like the it is like in the Gartner hype cycle, it is coming out of that trough of disillusionment, and you see a large flurry of activity in terms of investments, new companies which are coming up in this space. So we feel now that the time is right. You know, everything has to match, the technology, the cost, the need. Now is the time when everything is coming in place, and this is the time where QKD as a business is going to come out. This is a 2015 report of McKinsey, where world estimates in spending in quantum technologies is around 1,500 million euros. You can see that United States and China are into a big way into this. If you see the various companies in the QKD space, like I said, the technology didn't take off in a commercial way. But there are a lot of limitations to this. It's very sensitive, it's expensive, and there are technology limitations to this. And thankfully, we at QNU Labs, I can reveal so much that we have found out an Indian jugaad to the problem, and we hope to come out in a big way to solve this and make QKD universally adaptable. I cannot talk about it, but you'll hear about us very soon. We are the only company in India. So, like I said, many companies, many countries took up initiatives, but over the years that has petered out. Only recently, China, since it feels that it has fallen back in the technology race, whichever new technologies are coming, quantum computing, QKD, they are taking a lead into that. And they are the first country to have established a secure backbone, QKD secure backbone of 2,000 kilometers from Beijing to Shanghai. And probably this, they want to control information that goes through this. And they also partnered with US to build the measurement device independent QKD. And last year, they came out with a number of research papers on satellite-based QKD. They launched a satellite called MISIUS, named after a Chinese philosopher, purely for QKD. And they used the principle of entanglement for the first time at this such large distances. They sent beam photons, I said entangled photons to two different cities, spread 1,200 kilometers apart, and they were able to derive a key. And they also set up the world's first secure video conference call between Beijing and Vienna. On the other hand, on the quantum computing front, they are setting up the world's largest quantum computing research center in Hefei, spread over 37 acres and costing nearly $11 billion. And by 2020, they'll have a computer which can crack for military use, which can crack codes and also be used by submarines for navigation. On the other side, the three main big guns in the corporate world, Baidu, Alibaba, and Tencent, known collectively as BAT, they are also in a race amongst their own two. They have control of large-scale data, or big data, and they want to process that. So they are also very much interested in quantum computing. So these are the developments that are taking place. Some use cases where QKD can be used. Like I said, if you remove the limitations of range and bring down the cost, both of which we are doing, the use cases open up. Anywhere, any place you need secure communications, and you require that in today's age. Today when we are dependent on cyber operations so much, and data is all important, data is the new oil, you got to protect it. And as we go ahead, QKD is going to assume importance. A word about our company, QNU Labs. We are the first and only quantum cryptography company in the country. We were established, incubated out of IIT Madras after nearly 4 years of research there. And the director, the head of the Department of Optoelectronics, is a director in our company. Yeah, just about 1 year into operation, we already come out with our first product, that is the QNL-X100, which is a differential phase shift based QKD system. It's in the alpha prototype stage. We are coming out of the beta soon. Last year, we won the Elevate 100 for being amongst the 100 most innovative startups in Karnataka out of 1,700 companies. And we had a very good exposure in Defense Expo recently. We have an MOU with University of Edinburgh for combining Li-Fi with QKD. Now, you know that whatever security, Wi-Fi is the weakest link in your communication system. So we want to replace Wi-Fi with Li-Fi secured with QKD. That will be a high security solution for military command centers and stock exchanges, etc. And we have a manufacturing tie-up with Tejas Networks here in Bangalore. With that, I have finished with my talk. We are open for questions and answers. Vivek? And on a quantum computer, there are some problems in implementation. Actually, they solve the simplest problem. 5 into 3 is equal to 15, is the quantum computer was able to solve. But theoretically, practically, experimentally, proven safe, only the hardware has to rise to that level.
Okay. Any typical or commercial products which have come up in these days, because you are saying we are moving very soon to a quantum cryptography, right? So do we have any commercial products that are already implemented?
So some countries are, as far as we know, using proprietary algorithms for encryption, that they are free to do that. But we are not to come out with standardized algorithms, which NIST, ETSI all are working on. This year, probably in the next 2-3 years, you're going to have new specifications, and we'll have to all switch over to those specifications if we want to interact worldwide. And as far as that is for the cryptography, and QKD, there are a large number of companies which are coming up, so we are also in that tree.
Okay. See, in security, we say security through obscurity, right? If something which someone doesn't know, we think that it is secured. Like that, and just based on very, very high level knowledge which we are talking about, it looks very complex. But in security, we say keep it very simple so it is secure. But making it very complex will definitely have some loophole somewhere. Will quantum cryptography looks pretty complex?
No, not at all. You are just exchanging the key by means of photons. You are doing it at the photon level so that nobody can measure it. If you do the normal data, anybody can tap it. The device which I showed you, if you use that to tap, you will not be able to read the quantum data.
But that example which you have shown, if I am encrypting my channel using TLS protocol, are you saying still it
will be? Yes, AES-128, yeah.
Are you saying I'm using a TLS protocol or IPsec, whatever?
Yeah.
You cannot, even if you tap it, you will get the encrypted data, right?
Unless so what you do is you save that encrypted data. 2 years down the line, you will have the means to crack it. Today, we are facing requests, project requests from people, I won't name who, but people are sending us data saying that, can you decrypt it for us? People are already doing it. You're just waiting for the day somebody. Now, the TLS or whatever, if you use AES, like I said, there may be a class 4 employee who is feeding in the key. He doesn't know the value of the key. Go and offer him something, he'll probably give it to you. Crack it. Soon, you'll have the case where a bank is taken to ransom or something like that. You know, just a few days of data is enough to bring down a bank. You can just imagine that.
So this QNU Labs, you are taking the proven algorithms or you have your custom algorithms you are implementing, and based on that you are creating the products?
No, we are just building QKD, which is the standard thing.
Standard algorithm.
But standard has got certain drawbacks which meant that it has not been implemented so far. So we are going to change the paradigm. I cannot reveal more than that. But we are going to overcome this problem and make it affordable and implementable, irrespective of the distance.
Okay. You are also talking about when you are generating a key, the space, it shouldn't be reused and the key space should be wired.
So for that, you require a quantum random number generator. Now your random pseudo-random number generator, you can replicate those conditions under which the is using an algorithm to generate it. If you generate the initial conditions, you will get the same key. So it is more pseudo and less random. It's only a quantum random number generator.
But pseudo-random numbers, I agree. But say there are some hardware security module kind of a product which doesn't generate a pseudo-random number, right?
They use chaos, different ways of chaos.
Yeah. FIPS 140-2 certified products, they don't generate pseudo-random number. Like that, for the quantum cryptography,
we require.
Is it a same device we'll be using it, or it requires altogether a separate device?
No, same. And different. If it is, they have to pass the ENT test, DIHARD test, correct, NIST test. This is the requirement for cryptography. If any random number sequence passes this, it's good enough for cryptography.
Correct.
You see, it's not just the, if the key is biased in one way, then it's easier to decipher it. So there are various conditions. There are very stringent tests. So either you can use, it's called a TRNG, that is a truly random number generator,
correct,
or you have a quantum random number generator, where you use the quantum principles of passing it through a partially reflection mirror. No one can say which way it will go. If it goes through one way, it becomes one. If it goes through the other, it becomes zero. Using this principle, you can generate. We are building a QRNG also based on this principle.
In a normal cryptography, that FIPS 140-2 certification, right? Is it something very similar? You have it for quantum cryptography, or is it something is not available?
Right
as
now, there is no certifications.
Then how do you prove that, no, your algorithm is proven, secure? It's no, all still in a theoretical state.
We are not doing that. No, we are using the standard algorithm, AES-128. Only thing, we are giving good, robust keys to it, and we are ensuring that the key changes very fast. So if I have the key changing every minute, even if you have a quantum computer, if you want to take out information, every minute's data you'll have to decrypt. And how long that's going to take you? You have only Grover's algorithm. Shor's does not work on a symmetric key. Grover's also, if it is taking now 38 billion years, you will reduce it to maybe 12 billion. You still don't have 12 billion years to do it. So it is intractable.
So so does it mean that this QKD is only for key distribution,
exactly,
but for encryption, still you will be using it same AES-128 and AES-256?
Yes, that is the hybrid system. If you want super secure communications, you must generate a random number very fast and use that to OTP it with the stream. But then when you have 100 gigs of communication happening and your key generation rate is 1 Mbps, if you want to XOR, you can only have it to 1 Mbps. But if you want super secure, that nothing can crack, you can have super secure, say, 10G communications today with a 10G random number generator. But that's not good enough. So we use that as a key to AES. It's a hybrid solution.
Okay. So in case of RSA algorithms, they have given a benchmark of, if this is the key size, it takes to encrypt this much of data, this is a time or milliseconds,
yes,
or seconds,
yes,
it takes. Something very similar, do you have it for your quantum cryptography? If you are using it, what is the time it takes? Is that benchmark is already done or not yet?
No, no. So there are no standardization. That is in this technology, as yet there are no standardizations, there are no world standards or something. We got to build and convince people to use it. We have no alternative, because today this is the only alternative as a technology alternative to key distribution and to the threat of quantum computers. This is it. There's nothing else.
So two things to happen. One, if someone breaks RSA 2048,
yeah,
or the higher key sizes, then they will adopt or they will come to this. Or if you have a proven industry certification or whatever it is, only then people will come to this. Just by giving this information saying, hey, this is not secure, people may not believe and take it, right?
It depends on how much you price your data.
Fine.
It depends on how much. Suppose a highly secure, say, espionage agency, intelligence agency. Let me tell you that we already have an order book. We have an order pipeline, our products are not ready. There are people who are willing to buy it. Commercial adoption is something which we need to see, and we have got the via media or the interim solution to make it commercially acceptable. We need to see how it goes.
And government also should give
government
permissions, right?
Government.
Unless, because they have
in
to
fact,
tap all
in
the
fact,
communication.
Government initiatives in quantum, the part of our project like IIT, IIT has been funded through the government for the project. And in the next protocol, we are going to build the coherent one-way system, which will take our distance up to 200 kilometers. For that also, there's an Uchchattam Avishkar Yojana by the Pradhan Mantri's scheme, which we are using to fund it partially we are funding. So we are doing research through IIT Madras and doing the commercialization part in QNU. It's a kind of joint venture.
Okay, one last question. Generally, NSA allows only when they break the encryption algorithm, only then they allow country people to use it because they want to monitor the traffic.
Yeah.
For quantum cryptography, is it already happened or it's still not yet?
Not yet.
Okay. Right. Till that happened, they will not approve.
Even this policy document which recently government brought out the cyber security policy document in which those data security standards were laid down. There were a lot of objections from the industry. Again, they specified that we need to be able to tap in.
Exactly. Correct.
So unless the government will put its foot everywhere. But let's see, that was, paper was withdrawn. We need to see how it, where it goes from here now.
Thank you. Yeah.